I'm an endovascular neurosurgeon from Buffalo, New York. I've been using volumetric imaging for 4 years to help triage our stroke patients. I haven't seen any talks in your program about perfusion imaging, but the technology can apply to any organ. The same algorithms that we've helped develop or use in the brain are now being used in the heart to assess viability of tissue. And again, any organ specific of your interest, realize that this technology can be used. My background, I'm a biomedical engineer. I have a PhD in physics. I'm a neurosurgeon trained in open vascular and endovascular. Basically, it's about time I had gotten a job. I've been on faculty for 2 years in Buffalo. Multiple companies that we work with in the endovascular realm, each of them both in device design and in use of new equipment that comes out technology-based from them. 130 neurosurgery programs ranked in North America for academic productivity. We're very proud to be ranked seventh in that publication. We have a new facility in Buffalo. We've just built a $400 million hospital that is purely for vascular disease. We have 16 interventional suites with multiple specialties all working right next to each other. The interventional radiologists, the cardiologists, the vascular surgeons, and the neurosurgeons are all together in one suite, allowing as many possible interactions as we can. For example, the treatment of stent for stroke came out of treatment of stent for the heart. And so often nuances and developments in other fields can be then directly applied to some stuff that we're specific to. These would be specialties I'd never have a chance to interact with. So the ideology of this facility greatly facilitates progress. We recommend and welcome any visits if anyone would like to come and see what we're doing over there. Strokes, fourth leading cause of death, major cause of long-term disability. 5 million Americans currently living with the effects. It costs us $70 billion annually. And most of this is for the disabled and for disability and rehab. Every 45 seconds, someone has a stroke. By WHO, 15 million strokes in the world, 5.5 million deaths. Mostly ischemic, small percentage of hemorrhagic. Realize the classification includes everything. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, intraparenchymal hemorrhage, all considered strokes. We're focused on the ischemic stroke. A clot dislodges, blocks a blood vessel. Distally, that tissue is at risk. There's an increased time of flow to get to that area. But during that time frame, with the ability to recruit and vasodilate, you can pool blood in that region. And it's that volume increase that we're able to measure with perfusion imaging that lets us assess if the tissue is dead or alive. And that lets us say, we don't care what time window your stroke occurred in, we will attempt to treat you. And that's a major paradigm shift. I often ask people, do you know someone that's had an aneurysm or had an aneurysm rupture? And you often see a scattering of hands. Realize that there's 30,000 aneurysms that we treat around the country. There's over 800,000 stroke events. If we can make an impact on that disease process, we make a major impact on the economics. It's the most prevalent neurologic condition. It's the most common discharge diagnosis in nursing homes. It's the most common diagnosis treated in rehab. For some reason in Western New York, there is an unbelievable hotspot. We think of the Southern Stroke Belt. There's one zip code in our region that's 200% above the national average. And unfortunately, most of this is because our population does not go in for any regular checkups of any type. We're 25% below the national average for this. When we think of stroke, we realize education is crucial and risk factor reduction is crucial. By the time, unfortunately, a patient gets to me, it's full salvage. I'm trying to pull someone up after they've fallen off the cliff. And so the goal is to keep people away from that cliff, but I'm going to share with you some major advances in what we do in acute stroke treatment as well. We are one of, we've set up a hub and spoke model around our facility where we facilitate 11 neighboring hospitals. I will literally get on a reach-based system and examine a patient at outside hospital, make a decision about TPA or not, if that's appropriate, and then have them ship those patients to us. In doing such, we do about 2,500 stroke evaluations a year, and those all include perfusion-based studies. I bring this slide up to say everyone's trying to put on a stroke center on the on their hospital. There's a major difference between a stroke center comprehensive and other stroke centers. We have the ability, we have a neurocritical ICU as an infrastructure post-treatment. We have 24/7 CT and MR, 24/7 angio-based staff with four different endovascular neurosurgeons ready to take clots out at any point in time. We have an amazing triage base from our emergency room to a perfusion scanner to an angiogram suite. That type of infrastructure is significant, and I think what elevates us compared to other stroke centers. The current criteria from the American Heart and American Stroke Association is no routine anticoagulations recommended. This is an interesting subject or topic. I can't tell you how many times people showed up and they're already improving and they've taken 650 milligrams of aspirin at home when they had a symptom. But that's not the current recommendation because of worries about hemorrhage or hemorrhagic bleeds or subdurals. There has yet to ever be a problem in my hands of someone that came in on aspirin with a subdural that I can't treat with platelets or take them to the operating room and have major bleeding problems. But yet, many, many stroke patients get better in my eyes. We are attempting to try and reevaluate this from an emergency medicine perspective or EMS perspective, but I wonder how many people would be doing better if when they had symptoms right away they started to load themselves with aspirin. Aspirin is recommended within 24 or 48 hours as long as there's no bleed in the CAT scan. IV tPA in the very select criteria that make it for that drug. You know, there are 19 contraindications and multiple relative contraindications. There needs to be an exact time frame documented of when the event started and occurred. And they really have a 3-hour, somewhat limited extended to 4-hour window. In our hands, 1% or less of the people are eligible for that drug. When people say, hey, you know, 90% of our tPA people get the drug, what they're actually saying is, of the people that were eligible to get the drug, 90% got the infusion still in the right time frame. Okay? There's no group or facility that's TPAing 30% of the strokes that come in. Those numbers are non-practical. But imagine if you didn't have this time window. Imagine if you could look at the viability of the brain tissue, and if it is viable, have an intervention that could revascularize it. Think of how many more patients that opens up stroke intervention to. With the protocol I'm going to show you, we've been able to offer intervention to 35% of the people that show up, not less than 1%. In addition, we feel that for major clots, Vascular, M1, the drug does nothing. I'll show you data that suggests that tPA has very limited improvement in those patient populations, and going up and taking the clot out dramatically changes their course. IA thrombolysis less than 6 hours out, select cases of mercy penumbra. And this is the American Heart and Stroke Association current guidelines. And again, I suggest that there are many, many, many places around this country where, God forbid, your loved one woke up with a stroke. The only thing that they would be offered in their local area is an aspirin and good luck. We have to think of the economics of this also for the hospital. Medical stroke management, DRG, pays about $5,000. TPA pays about $10,000. In various institutions around the country, intervention can pay the hospital $35,000 to $50,000. That's a huge impetus for you to tell your CEO of your organization it may be worth looking at the investment. If you do 100 to 200 interventions per year, that's a pretty good benefit to your hospital base. There is no real significant benefit, unfortunately, to the endovascular neurosurgeon that's doing it, or IR guy. We don't get paid much. It's still considered experimental. But again, as you'll see, we do it because we think it's the right thing to do. We're on the forefront. Eventually, that will catch up. So the key for our paradigm is why stop at a specific time threshold? There's plenty of data that suggests the viability of tissue well beyond even 24 hours. And so the two key things that we've been implementing are functional imaging to assess viability of tissue and immediate acute recanalization from an endovascular intervention standpoint. Our protocol is a CT stroke study, and I'll go into the explain exactly what parameters we look for in that, when the patient hits the door of anyone that we're suspecting stroke in. If we do not see a large penumbra or area at risk, then the patient goes right to MR. Our ER loves this because triage-wise, they get the patients out immediately. And again, it's non-COBRA violations to send someone from another hospital on the floor that may have a stroke immediately to our ER facility and triage right through this pathway that we've set up. If there is a perfusion deficit, they go immediately to angio. Okay? We're able to get patients on the table from the time they hit the door in about 45 minutes. That's including the CT scan and transport. Post-intervention, we'll get a CAT scan or a GRE-based MRI because often with all the contrast they get, especially when there's an occlusion, imagine a distal M1 occlusion, all those lenticks take up the dye, and there'll be lots of basal ganglia staining. And if we want to continue some form of antiplatelet or medicine afterwards, we're often concerned and wait for a follow-up CT that shows that that dye staining has gone away. Well, GRE 1 hour out can benefit us significantly. It can tell the difference between hemorrhage and that dye staining. Post-op day one, they'll get a repeat perfusion study, an MRI a few days later, and then a follow-up CT or MRI. All these patients are collected prospectively in registry. There are 340 closed or active acute stroke trials that we all pay for. Of all of those trials, only the six listed are intervention trials. And not a single one of those, other than two at the bottom, the Saracen Erase, which are Buffalo stroke trials, have used perfusion-based imaging as selection criteria. Every other one of those trials is a time-based selection and drug A versus drug B. Since we published perfusion-based imaging in 2009, 2010, there have been this list of trials with only one other one doing acute intervention. In each of the trials that we've looked at recanalization, the key is recanalization is important for improved outcome. It makes sense. You open up the vessel, the patients get better. Okay? The time to recanalization is also crucial. With all this single center prospective-based data, however, there still is not level one evidence. There isn't even level one evidence to support it against medical-based therapy alone. Because of this, and toward the end I'll describe it, we are currently doing a randomized trial in Buffalo for wake-up strokes using perfusion imaging with medical therapy versus TPA versus intervention. It's a difficult trial to do as an interventionalist, and again, I'll speak to that a little bit toward the end. I'm going to describe the perfusion-based imaging, but in addition, I want to describe the evolution of the technology that I'm currently using. We started to use IA. We've currently used Mercy and Penumbra selectively. We started stenting for stroke, and now we've moved to stent retrievers, where we can stent the vessel, pull out clots, and not leave any heavy metal behind. TPA, which is the current standard of care, there's only 10% recanalization of an ICA occlusion, 30% for an MCA with reocclusion rates as high as 35%. IA thrombolysis in less than 6 hours, 66 recan rate, 10% symptomatic hemorrhage rate, reocclusion rate of 15%. So this is the baseline of where we are starting from. These are the major intervention trials. The real key is to look to the first column, the NINDS is the TPA study. And you look at 6% symptomatic hemorrhage on the drug, a modified Rankin score of 0 to 2, which is independent. It's a very crude scale that assesses the independence of the patient. It's 40% or 39% independent and a mortality rate of 17%. When we looked in 2009, 2010, at our data, and we're currently looking at 2011, 2012, all comers, all technology, everybody that hit the table, we had a 9% symptomatic hemorrhage rate and about 39% modified Rankin score of independence, similar to TPA. Now, if you're looking at this, you're saying, well, you're not doing any better. What's the difference? The difference is it's not 1% or less of the people. It's 30% of the population that walks in. And in this treatment arm includes people all the way up to 24 to 36 hours out from their stroke event. Breaking it down, when I look at people less than 8 hours out using perfusion imaging, 6% hemorrhage rate, 45% of the people went home independently. These were all Buffalo-based data and studies. Looking at greater than 8 hours out, again, a patient population where I suggest most of your institutions wouldn't touch them, we send 1/5 of them home independently. When we use stent for stroke, 100% of our patients are getting recanalized on the table. This is another interesting arm, the 0 to 3 hour treatment arm. We're taking TPA failure patients. There's great ultrasound data that suggests by the time the infusion is done on the drug, the clot better be broken down, and that can be done based on ultrasound looking at it. And those are the only select patients that would get better in 3 months. So that if by after the infusion, an hour after, the patient has no clinical improvement, we can show that taking them to the intervention suite still offers me significant improvement in their independence and outcome. These publications have come up multiple journals, from neurosurgery journals to stroke. In looking at those 2 years' data, the other interesting finding for us was that by shifting to an MR from an MR to a CT-based triage protocol saved our hospital about $350,000 a year. The length of stay reduction by aggressively offering intervention when the patient walked in the door, as well as sometimes just having a family face the decision of a 90-year-old debilitated person, do we want to go to intervention or do we want to just let nature take its course? There's no longer this middle of the road of, well, let's give her an aspirin and see how she does on the floor for a few days. Just those type of discussions up front have saved the hospital about 350 in length of stay, including mainly when we do intervene, which I'll show you, we can get 60% improvement in their discharge disposition. 60% more people went home independently than before we implemented this type of triage. This was a case that I did my senior fellowship year in 2008. It was right before we started to get the Aquilian scanner, but it was the first time I think I really appreciated or understood that if you can revascularize a territory, there will always be a potential for improvement. It's very different than leaving that vessel shut down for good. Okay. This was a 34-year-old woman that was at a truss training session in the Toronto area. All right. And obviously it didn't go so well. They were holding her by some rope three stories up. I don't know the details. She hit the ground. Okay. After hitting the ground, she was able to talk for a few seconds and then immediately was only able to blink her eyes. Classic for a locked-in type of stroke. Classic for a dissection of either her basilar or vertebral arteries. She was 9 hours out from this event. No one in the Toronto area would take care of her. OHIP, the Ontario Health System, called our hospital and said, do you have anything to offer this woman? We said, we'll take a look. They knew we were doing acute stroke interventions well beyond time windows. She had an NIH of 18 and a CT that showed no hemorrhage. When we follow our NIHs of 16 to 20, the NIH stroke scale is a stroke scale that assesses severity of stroke. Zero is perfect. 30 is a death sentence, and I'll also show you that 15 to 20 is not much better, okay? Every single part of our neurologic exam gets a point for a deficit, basically. When we follow our 16 to 20s, and remember she was an 18, 200 people followed just in medical therapy for this. Basically, 90% were dead in 30 days, with 5% severely disabled. I'll go on to tell you that the three-month follow-up for this was 97% mortality. So we have this cohort of severe stroke patient that does not do well, period. This woman fell into that category. I also have the data I showed you before that, given the right selection criteria, I could potentially send one-fifth of the patients greater than 8 hours out home independently. And often when you present this data to a family, even though this is considered experimental, they will often say, please take a look. She had bilateral vert dissections. This is the dominant vert ending midway up. What we do is we go up with a fine, very, very soft and flexible wire. And the key is to navigate blindly beyond the clot and stay inside the vessel. We'll navigate and where I expect the wire to go beyond the clot, make the turns as expected through distal V2, V3, up into the basilar, and here out into the PCA, bring a very small catheter to follow over that wire, and pull the wire out, and then inject some dye into that, praying that the dye is filling a distal vessel. Once you see that you're distally intravascular, now you can start to work. In her, we reconstructed basically from the distal basilar down into the vertebral artery with literally 6 stents. In doing that, in reestablishing flow to her brainstem, she sure still did end up with a severe mid-pons and brainstem stroke. But what she taught me was that she didn't look that good the first day after. By the first week, she slowly started to regain some distal, just wiggling her toes. The family wanted to stay very aggressive with her. Peg, trach, months in rehab. This is her at 6 months.
My name is Patsy DeCeder. I had a stroke in November. I just want to say thank you very much, Dr. Levy, for all your help and not giving up.
Not giving up on me.
And how is it going? How are you feeling?
I feel great.
Now, obviously, you're able to talk very clearly, and
I'm getting my speech back little by little. My hands are okay now. This one is still not that great. My left side is still affected a little bit, but I gotta wear the leg brace. But, you know, I'm doing better. I can walk around the house without the cane. I'm doing really good. My swallowing is getting better. Everything. Little by little, every day, baby steps. Like you said to me, baby steps. So that's what I'm doing.
Okay, go right ahead.
Miracle.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. You gotta do your flips.
I'm not there yet.
Not yet.
Wow.
Give me a week. Yeah. So I'm doing really good. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Dr. Levy. You're awesome.
I wonder how many institutions, again, would have offered that woman treatment. And it isn't one story. I'm going to show you prospectively story after story after story. And it also isn't that everyone does well. You know, I told you that only 50% or 45% of these people are going out independently. And yes, some are hemorrhaging. And we've adjusted our selection criteria to minimize that intraparenchymal hemorrhage to that area at risk and maximize my ability to make them better. But again, how many stories like this do you need to see or hear before you'd consider this for your loved one or allow us or an interventionalist with this criteria to intervene on one of your family members given the alternative? The Aquilian came not so long after this, this woman's intervention, and what it did is allowed us a full volumetric imaging set of the brain. We were one of the first to implement it in North America. With a single rotation around the head, we get a full image of the brain. We're able to take 19 snapshots of an arterial, capillary, and venous phase, and basically recreate an angiogram. Okay. Just because a perfusion map shows an abnormality doesn't mean that the problem, that the patient is having a deficit. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with, again, these images. Where the maps are doesn't make a difference, but I'll just quickly point out, this is a time map suggesting, again, significant delay in time to this part of the brain, consistent with the occlusion we're seeing here. This is a mean transit time map, this is a flow map, and a volume map. What you'll see is there aren't many deficits or any deficits in the flow and volume map. Well, that's because the patient is intact, and the patient has been able to bring PEEL collateralization all the way back distal to the occlusion. Patient doesn't need an intervention. It's the clinical exam that really tells me my penumbra or my tissue at risk. The images are just something that associate with it. So for example, when someone shows up with a significant deficit, aphasia in right hemiparesis, and it's taking a lot of time to get to this territory, and the blood flow is down, but the volume map is relatively preserved. There's pooled blood here. This is a perfect candidate for revascularization. And when we open up the vessels, the perfusion maps go perfectly to normal. In this patient specifically, there were two M1 occlusions on that side of the brain. And when we opened them up, we literally opened them by pulling chunks of clot out. And when we say we pull chunks of clot, we pull sometimes centimeters of clot out of the brain. And there is no drug that will be able to chew through that in a time frame sufficient for that brain tissue to stay viable. I'll go into some of the specifics of some of the devices, but you may have heard of Mercy. A Mercy device, basically, you go beyond the clot, attempt to capture the clot in this corkscrew device, and pull out the clot. A penumbra device is basically like a roto-rooter. We set up a suction prior to the clot and chew up little bits of the clot, hoping that it comes back and gets aspirated into the suction tubing. And mainly where we've been moving in technology is stenting. And it's amazing that when you're able to stent the clot and plaster the clot against the wall, for some reason we don't ever get major perforator injury. Imagine that along the basilar. It's amazing to me that I can put a stent in mid-basilar and don't have a ton of perforator stroke injury. So with the Aquiline 1, our current protocol is a CT of the head without contrast, and then 19 volumes with 50 cc's of contrast at 5 cc's a minute. The first is a mask, then we then capture the arterial phase, and then 5 hits at the venous phase. And you're able to get an MA boost to get a very high resolution CTA with this sequence. You can also drop the MA in that mid-region, arterial region, just to get a crude perfusion study. Each and every voxel will have this time attenuation curve. And basically the key is comparing that to some reference arterial and venous curves. You then can apply different mathematical models to assess the parameters of time to peak, mean transit time, flow, and volume. There's been a lot of interest in the amount of radiation this technology takes. Okay. In our hands, compared to the 64, where we had to pick 4 slices, okay, and do 10 image sets at each slice, that dose was about 313 milligray. A CT of the head's about 80 milligray. When we look at the perfusion images of those 19 slices and add them up, we're at about 170 milligray, so 2 CTs of the head without contrast. So that's our current basis, and that's with the MA boost. It drops a little bit lower when you don't use the MA boost, and that's without ADER technology. We're just implementing ADER into this right now. With all of those in place, we're expecting it to be equivalent to 1.5 CTs of the head without contrast or less. So in fact, I think we're getting more for less. There are various algorithms that we've been closely implementing with Vital and with Toshiba in terms of checking, validating, and assessing. And most of the maps right now are using deconvolution technology. And we have this, what's called a delay-insensitive deconvolution map that we currently use. What's interesting about that technology is, for example, if I have a carotid stenosis that's severe and I have a superimposed M1 stenosis, it used to be that the carotid stenosis would delay out the whole hemisphere of the brain, and we would never be able to see a secondary superimposed stenosis. By using this delay in sensitivity, it resets the clock the minute the blood gets to the brain and lets us do a separate calculation. That is allowing us to see significant tandem stenosis. There's a lot of publications out there about how widely variable different vendors' technology for this tool are. And it makes sense. Deconvolution itself can have a wide variability in how you do it. The way I approach this is the same way we approach an INR for coagulation. There has to be an internalized calibration standard for what you're doing, okay? And if you're able to internally validate the numbers you're using, then it seems that that's currently the best that we can do. We've developed a perfusion model that's a deterministic model that has a defined flow and a defined volume, and it's a grid. And if my scanner can't get that right, then I would never check it as being an absolute right on a patient. But I do use relative values right now. It's one hemisphere compared to the other, and that allows me, again, to get around the criticism of there's technical limitations to the absolute values of these numbers. I agree with that wholeheartedly. There's a great meta-analysis of data that looks at tissue, given these parameters, to try and assess when the tissue is dead. And basically what happens is, it's no surprise, there's significantly prolonged time for blood to get to that region of the brain is step one. Step two is the flow drops off significantly. But as long as you can auto-regulate and bring pooled blood, hypervolemia even at the beginning, that tissue is viable. And only once that volume map drops specifically. Now, we used to use about 30%. So I would let the tissue at risk drop 70% from its baseline compared to the other side before I said that tissue is dead, I won't go up on this patient. And we were getting some intraparenchymal hemorrhages with that, about 15% of our patients. We've since started to cherry pick, I'll say, and we get 50%. I only let the volume maps drop 50% compared to the other side, and then take that patient for intervention. Still doing such, we're still intervening on more than 150 patients a year. Again, there's plenty of data suggesting time is brain in animal studies. And what's interesting about this is I don't always rely on the perfusion study. And here's an example. God forbid a cardiologist working next to me has an acute stroke on the table. I know the clot event just happened 10 minutes ago. That patient may get a quick perfusion study and show the tissue's dead already. The tissue's not bringing volume there. but I know there's a certain time window for metabolic death. It takes time for the metabolic death pathway to occur, and I'll often still attempt to intervene on that patient if it's less than 30 minutes out from an event, okay? So that's the only time where I don't use my volume maps as a major rigorous criteria. Anything outside of that, I use the volume maps. Again, I just mentioned, rather than worrying about drawing out the penumbra, which I often do based on the time delay, my patient's clinical exam is truly my penumbra. And then volume, if I had to pick one thing at 3 a.m. in the morning to help me decide whether I'm going to take this patient or not, it's simply looking only at the core volume map itself. Are they pooling blood, or is there no pooled blood in that territory? And I never ask the question, when did it occur? Doesn't matter to me if it's 24 hours out. And clinical exam. If their stroke is very mild, I will not put them through the risk of an intervention. If their NIH is a 2, I don't even consider it. But greater than 5, that's a deficit that may start to limit your ability to go home independently, especially receptive speech. I'm extremely aggressive about receptive speech. If a receptive language stroke completes itself, that patient is non-rehabable. They don't understand the world around them, and they can no longer interact with anyone. This is an example when we first started to implement. These were part of our 2 stent for stroke studies. 62-year-old, 3 days out from major surgery, off of her Coumadin, NIH of 15, 9 hours after her surgical event. So she had an event, peri-procedural, peri-surgery. These are the old perfusion maps that you may be more accustomed to. This is time on the bottom, okay? So the problem in this region, flow is down in this region, but if you notice, there's actually a hypervolemia in this patient's perfusion imaging. Again, the perfect candidate for intervention. M1 occlusion, AP angiogram. You can see the eye sockets here, okay? So looking straight on up the internal carotid branching, M1 occlusion right there. We go up. I'll pass a small wire beyond this, feel for where I expect the normal drop and rise in M2 going up to the Sylvian point. I'll then bring that catheter out. This is an example of an injection through the catheter, showing it's intravascular, and through the guide, showing where the clot starts. I use measurements from where the guide starts to how far out I think that clot is, and then through that small catheter, I'm able to deliver a folded up stent. And as the stent expands outside the catheter, what's interesting is I'm able to immediately revascularize that territory, okay? Right off the table, that perfusion map is normalized. This patient went from an NIH of, I think it was 15 to start, to a 2. 12-point improvement significantly and discharged home. We've also learned to try and tailor the devices for the patient. Often when we hear stuttering symptoms over a few days, what I will do is shoot the other vessels prior to shooting the vessel of interest. And this patient presented with an NIH of 12, again, with an initial symptom that was stuttering over a few days, so it's hard to ever get an ictus. Perfusion map, increased in time, slight increase in volume, slight decrease in volume, but not less than 50% of the other side. In looking at the other vessels, you see ICAD everywhere. So the most common problems with an acute stroke event are either thrombus from somewhere else or an acute plaque rupture in the vessel. It doesn't matter how many stroke retrieval devices you use on ICAD, that plaque will always be there. You can go up and think you're suctioning out clot, the plaque will just keep on shutting on itself. So when we see ICAD, we think to either go in plasty or go in and leave a stent behind immediately so we're not wasting hours of intervention time. This patient went right up with an angioplasty balloon, aspirated with the angioplasty. Immediately, this was the balloon up in the vessel at the area of the occlusion. Immediately got recanalization. The vessel is not perfect. There's still a small plaque there, but it doesn't need to be perfect. We just need to have distal flow. Immediate improvement in the perfusion map, and NH of 5 off the table. 2 years ago, I used to think that this was as high of evolved as stroke intervention could be. And I'll explain since this where we have evolved. But this was a 41-year-old who presented with an NH of 19 at one of our outside hospitals. We interviewed the patient with a video camera at that outside hospital because they did not have 24/7 neurology coverage for TPA. The patient met the criteria for the drug. We gave him the drug, and we said, ship him to us, okay? It took 3 hours for that patient to get into our hands. The patient had no neurologic improvement on the drug, remained in NIH at 19. CT of the head showed no hemorrhage. This was around the time where we had both the 64 and the 320 working, and we had another patient on the 320. I should have waited. I don't know why we didn't wait, but I ended up with a standard perfusion map. And again, you have to select where you're going to put those four slices. And we always usually choose MCA distribution. Well, everything looked normal, okay? So I missed the basilar occlusion, or the distal V4 occlusion on this patient. But we took the patient for intervention anyway. But in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, I don't know how much of the cerebellum and the brainstem are stroked. I have no idea. It's never a great angiogram when you fill the ICA and you see all this backfilling to the basilar. But to be honest, thank God he had that cross flow across the PCOM, or else, again, I have no idea how much of a deficit he would have had. Okay, but there for sure was an occlusion distal V4, and his left vert did not fill. So he was living off of this. What we were thinking, what I thought at the time was, can I deliver a stent to establish flow and then recapture the stent? I don't want to leave a patient that I don't know how much of this tissue is stroked on aspirin and Plavix with the fresh metal stent. So we opened up an Enterprise stent, which is a closed cell stent, which allows me to unsheath it and resheath it, unsheath it and resheath it. I would open up the stent, I would get great flow, I'd wait 5 minutes, I'd capture the stent, no flow, it would shut down. We did this 2 times. By the third time, flow beget flow. We were able to recapture the stent, and we were able to continue to establish flow to the brainstem. You can see over here, there still is that ICAD plaque lesion just sitting there, but there's flow beyond it. The perfusion scanner, so this was our final run. The perfusion scanner, of course, was open afterwards, which again, I wish I would have done before, but I wonder if I would have done something differently, because in this imaging study, increased time, decreased flow, and badly decreased volume, and he went on to stroke that cerebellar hemisphere. I had to do a decompressive craniectomy, I had to take half of his cerebellum, I had to put an EVD in this patient, okay? After that stay, he was finally discharged in NIH of 7. I brought him back 30 days later and definitively treated that ICAD lesion with the xerolimus-coated stent and made that vessel look perfect. At that point in time, I felt very comfortable putting the patient on aspirin and Plavix. NIH of 3 by 30 days. Every single patient has a very unique treatment course. It is impossible for me to imagine a randomized study where you look at some pathway like this and say, how do you judge the outcome? How do you judge his 24-hour, 48-hour outcome from an intervention that will continue? But again, I think the key in listening to that is that there can be very complex treatment pathways for these people. We published that, and coming off of that idea of, can I put a stent in, get the clot out, or reestablish flow and keep the stent out, companies have piggybacked that with actual stent retrievers, they're called. And so what we have with the stent retriever literally is a stent on a stick where its goal is to go into the parent vessel, capture clot, and pull clot out, never leaving a stent behind. What's interesting about it is compared to all the other devices, the minute the stent is opened, you've reestablished flow. The minute the stent pushes the clot against the wall, blood is flowing to that region. None of the other devices allow that. So just by going up and opening the stent, we can improve recanalization and potentially not have to keep these patients on aspirin and Plavix. The other interesting thing is there are times when we need to leave stents behind. This is a fusiform distal ICA, mid-MCA aneurysm. In mid-aneurysm, I have an occlusion event. So now I'm sick to my stomach. I've got to go through an aneurysm, through a clot in the middle of this aneurysm, find a distal M2 vessel, all right, and hope I haven't perforated or ruptured it. This is a classic scenario where I'm not messing around with any different device. I'm going up, and if I get through, and if it's safely through, I am stenting off the vessel. So within one pass of passing through this mid-fusiform rhythm stroke, I was able to deploy an Enterprise stent and, again, reestablish flow immediately. With that as the outcome on MRI. So there are places for leaving it behind. but the rest of the talk will be on can I recapture them. The other devices also show a little bit less efficacy. Again, Mercy would recan up to 65% of the time with recanalization rates as high as 35%. Penumbra 80% of the time, but took a long time to chew through the clot. Stents, we can reopen up these vessels almost 100% of the time, but we are limited in our location. These are major vessel occlusions. These are the two of the three newest technologies out there that we're part of clinical trials with. The stents are no longer these fine mesh stents. They're now these wide open cells that are attempting to integrate into the clot. This is a 50-year-old, 8 hours out, NIH of 16. Perfusion study showing excellent volume. Right M1 occlusion. We cross the lesion. That's the wire distal, the microcatheter along with it. And then we deliver this technology that I'm showing right here, which is a lead wire and a very tapered, wide-celled stent. We leave that in place for about 5 minutes, allowing that to incorporate and embed into the clot. And then we pull and aspirate as we're pulling and pull out chunks of clot. With a single pass, we are able to completely revascularize that territory. NIH improved immediately from 16 to 5, NIH3 the following day, discharge in NIH 0. Again, story after story after story, we continue to publish our large series year after year. This is the follow-up MRI. This is a 73-year-old man in NIH at 20, 9 hours out. Again, how many of these patients would be getting any intervention at your institutions? Perfusion studies, again, are our crucial selection criteria for these people. They must have this type of volume map preservation. Right M1 occlusion. This one shows the stent in place with the distal tine and us pulling us back through on the lateral map through M1 and pulling that stent out. During that whole time, we're aspirating at the base through our guide catheter. Immediate recanalization, NIH of 5 on the table. Again, there's of all of the things that I've been fortunate enough or blessed to be able to do in terms of treatment from tumors to children to spine, there's nothing more powerful than having someone who can't speak and can't move their arm and leg help themselves get off the table and thank you. It's an incredible, incredible experience to be a part of. These stents are only viable right now for large vessel. We're working on smaller technology for distal. They will probably only work for certain lengths of clot because the longest stents we have are about 40 millimeters. Can't quite use them at bifurcations yet, although pulling out any clot helps. We can always go up multiple times in different distributions. And that permanently leaving that aspirin and Plavix is the hard part for us right now. So again, stent-trievers are the wave of the future. The current problem with the first two trials we were part of with the stent-trievers were even though we were aspirating from the neck, we're still getting a lot of distal emboli. And so what we've started to do was now combine the aspiration technology with the stent retrieval technology. We will now put a distal catheter proximal to the occlusion site and turn on a suction tube. And now we have a catheter right by the clot that's pulling backwards. We'll balloon occlude the carotid in the neck so that there's no flow going forward at all. And then we will pull back the clot into that suction catheter and pull everything out. So their terms are Sulnumbra and Trinumbra. Again, just a combination of these solitaire retrieval stents with suction catheters. The newest technology that's just been out in the past few months is a new 3D technology where you no longer have a stent that will just embed itself in plaster against the wall, but there's actual tines within the center of the stent as well that will help to grab, catch, embed clot, allowing maximal retrieval. We've had two cases in Buffalo using this device. The Europeans' experience is unbelievably exciting for us to see. 92% revascularization, 100% select successful delivery, 100% successful retrieval, and only one to one and a half average passes. Again, 1 to 2 passes per patient, with no vessel injury, vasospasm, or embolization observed. So it seems that stent retrieval is the wave of the future. The aspiration thrombectomy in combinations offers us great benefit. Realize that none of this, that I wouldn't even offer these treatment strategies to my patients without the volumetric imaging that gives me the comfort that when I reestablish blood flow to this territory, I'm not unleashing blood into dead brain, which would just hemorrhage. We're currently part of these three major trials in Buffalo, which are looking at these stent-retriever technologies. And I'd mentioned this earlier, it's very difficult for me as an interventionalist to say to someone, I have this ability to go up and potentially take the clot out, but I don't have randomized clinical trial data that suggests this is the right thing to do. Because I don't, we can either attempt the retrieval, given these selection criteria, or I could enroll you in a trial, and in that trial, you will either get nothing, get TPA'd, or get intervention. That's kind of how I phrase it to them and give them the opportunity. And there are people that say, well, let's try the trial. And I'm very thankful and fortunate to them. And I sleep at night by saying I've offered them the opportunity to go up and intervene and given them the options and the alternative. But it'll be very interesting as this data comes out to help us potentially develop some significant level one evidence that what we're doing, what we think we're doing, is truly helpful to the patients. The last thing I want to bring up is trying to combine the evolution of perfusion imaging with our angiographic data on table. We're currently doing a lot of LCI spins and working with evolution of can I get a CT equivalent on the table. And this is a patient with an M1 occlusion, all right? And post-intervention, this is that type of contrast extrav that I was talking about, which you can see on CT. This is an LCI spin on the table. I'm able to check EVD catheter placement. I'm able to check, again, for new clot, new hemorrhage post-intervention. And we're working toward the ability to assess time delay, flow data, and volume data real time on the table. It may allow me to stop an intervention halfway through it because I've adequately perfused the territory. Thank you all for your time. I welcome any questions.